Distinguished future physicians, welcome to Stomp on Step 1, the only free video series that helps you study more efficiently by focusing on the highest yield material. I'm Brian McDaniel, and I will be your guide on this journey through the flu. This is the sixth video in my playlist covering microbiome, and we are going to review the influenza virus, as well as viral genetics such as reassortment, genetic drift, and genetic shift. Influenza virus causes the flu. Influenza should not be confused with the bacteria Haemophilus influenza, aka H flu. The influenza virus causes a very common acute respiratory tract infection. Classically, it presents as fatigue, rhinorrhea, runny nose, myalgia, muscle pain, fever, cough and sore throat, and headache. There are laboratory tests available, but the flu is almost always a clinical diagnosis. It is spread mainly through air via respiratory droplets. Symptoms usually begin a couple days after being infected, but some patients remain asymptomatic. Most symptomatic patients will recover completely within 1 to 2 weeks. Sometimes it is difficult to tell the difference between the flu and the common cold, which is caused by a different virus. There is a lot of overlap in symptoms between the two, but the flu is usually more severe and lasts longer. A high fever and body aches are also more often associated with the flu. Question stems usually mention the time of year, as a majority of the flu cases within the U.S. occur between November and April. There is not a definitive answer as to why the flu occurs during the winter, but it could just be due to people being indoors and in close proximity more often. Other potential contributing factors include increased travel during the holidays and dry air. The question stem may also give you a big clue by mentioning that the patient is unvaccinated or that they had a recent sick contact. Usually, the flu is self-limited and only supportive treatment with over-the-counter medications is needed. Antiviral treatment is recommended for patients at high risk of complications. It should be started within the first 2 days of symptom onset. The general public thinks of the flu as a relatively mild infection. However, serious complications and even death are possible, especially in high-risk populations. There are hundreds of thousands of deaths worldwide attributed to the flu each year. The infection can spread into the lower respiratory tract and cause viral pneumonia, or weaken the immune system, leading to a secondary bacterial infection, aka superinfection. Children, pregnant women, and the elderly have a higher risk for complications. Patients with a history of smoking, COPD, asthma, immunosuppression, and other health conditions also have increased risk. There is, of course, a yearly influenza vaccine, aka flu shot, that you should be very familiar with. As a medical personnel, you are probably required to get it every year by your school or healthcare organization. The vaccine is recommended for nearly everybody, but is especially important in high-risk individuals. It is available in inactive and live attenuated forms. Since it takes a lot of time to make millions of vaccines, predictions have to be made in advance about what strains of the virus will be most common the next year. Unfortunately, sometimes these predictions end up being partially wrong. This is why in certain years the vaccine isn't as effective as others. Even in the best of years, the vaccine isn't 100% effective, as there is a lot of variety among influenza viruses. This is one of the reasons some patients believe the flu vaccine doesn't work. Even worse, there's a widespread belief that you can get the flu from the flu vaccine, which is highly unlikely. Part of this belief may be related to the fact that it takes a couple weeks after getting the vaccine for it to kick in. Therefore, some people will get the infection before the vaccine starts working and claim that the vaccine didn't work. Alternatively, Patients may get another virus, such as the common cold, after getting the vaccine and mistakenly think they got the flu. Some patients also have a mild reaction after receiving the vaccine that includes mild flu-like symptoms. This mild reaction may mistakenly be understood as an infection and a failure of the vaccine. More serious allergic reactions are possible, and the vaccine is contraindicated in those with severe egg allergy. Here is the table we keep referencing during our virus videos. You can see that the influenza virus is enveloped with a lipid outer layer. The virus also has a single-stranded RNA genome. Interestingly, the RNA is split into about eight separate segments similar to the rotavirus. The segmented nature of these genomes allow the RNA segments to be exchanged between viruses, a process known as reassortment. In this case, two different influenza viruses infect a single host, and a mixture of their genome segments can create a new virus with much higher virulence. The sudden change in the virus genome caused by reassortment is called genetic shift, and it is responsible for pandemics or global disease outbreaks. Typically, this involves a human strain of the virus gaining a completely new surface antigen from a strain of the virus which typically resides in another species. This new surface antigen means that the human immune system can no longer detect the virus based on experience gained from previous encounters with the influenza virus. A recent example includes the swine flu pandemic, which was caused by a combination of genomes from pig and human strains of the virus. There is also a more gradual process for the influenza virus to adapt, called genetic drift. In this process, mutations slowly accumulate in the virus genome. This leads to an increasing diversity within the virus. In particular, mutations that affect the surface antigens of the virus are important. Some of these mutations will give the virus a survival advantage that allows it to cause epidemics, aka the seasonal flu outbreaks that are mostly restricted to individual countries. However, since the new version of this virus still resembles strains from previous epidemics, parts of the population remain immune. Here is a table to summarize the difference between genetic drift and genetic shift. Shift is caused by reassortment of the segmented viral genome, often across multiple species. The change is sudden. It results in the virus gaining a completely new surface antigen, so nearly everyone is susceptible to the virus. It can lead to yearly epidemics or worldwide pandemics. It is present in influenza type A, which is the type of influenza present in multiple different species. Rotavirus, which also has a segmented genome, can have genetic shift too. Genetic drift is the accumulation of random mutations that slowly leads to a surface antigen that is slightly different than subtypes of the virus that caused the year's previous epidemic. Drift generally doesn't cause pandemics and leads to less serious yearly epidemics as some of the individuals in the population remain immune, since this new type of the virus looks similar to subtypes present in the population the previous year. Genetic drift is present in influenza A, B, and the rare type C, as well as many different species of virus. This table is available on my website if you'd like to download it. Hemagglutinin, HA, and neuraminidase, NA, are glycoproteins on the outside of the influenza virus envelope. You can see HA here in yellow and NA here in red. This picture also shows the segmented RNA genome. Hemagglutinin is important for the virus to be able to bind to target cells and insert its viral genome. Neuraminidase is important during the process of the virus releasing offspring from the infected cell. There are many subtypes of hemagglutinin and neuraminidase, but only H1 through H3 and N1 and N2 are found commonly in humans. You have likely heard of subtypes of the influenza A virus, such as H1N1, which includes hemagglutinin 1 and neuraminidase 1. This is the subtype of the virus that caused the Spanish flu pandemic in 1918 and the swine flu pandemic in 2009. Alternatively, influenza type A, subtype H5N1, more commonly referred to as bird flu, was the center of media attention in 2008. You don't need to know the history of these subtypes for the exam, but I included them in case you find them interesting. Since HA and NA are so integral to the function of the virus, they are targets for preventing and treating influenza. The body creates antibodies against hemagglutinin. These antibodies bind to HA, thereby inhibiting the attachment of the virus to the surface of the host cells. Individuals with antibodies against certain types of HA are immune to that subtype of the virus. Neuraminidase inhibitors are a class of antiviral drugs that prevent the release of viruses by inhibiting the action of the neuraminidase enzyme. Examples include zanamivir and oseltamivir, Tamiflu. If the patient is diagnosed within 48 hours of the onset of symptoms, one of these medications can be added to the treatment regimen to lessen the severity and decrease complications. However, antipyretics and analgesics are usually sufficient for treatment. That brings us to the end of our video. I want to send a big thanks to Julia Esparza from Shreveport, whose donation on stomponstep1.com helped fund this video. If you enjoyed this video and want to make it easier to find more videos from my series, please click on the orange box here to subscribe. It really helps me out. If you would like to be taken directly to the next video in the microbiology section, you can click on this black box here if you're watching on a computer. Thank you for watching and good luck with the rest of your studying.